Hi everyone, and welcome to the final installment of my top 50 board games of all time for the 2021 into 2022 season. So this, of course, is the absolute pinnacle of the list, my 10 favourite games at this very moment. But before I get into the list, I just wanted to give a massive shout out to Kienda.co.uk, who are my go-to online retailer in the UK, offer an amazing range of games at great prices, offer free postage at orders £30 plus, and very kindly, on behalf of Kienda.co.uk, they've offered me a discount code, which I'll leave below. And if you use that code at the checkout on orders £40 plus, then you will get a £5 discount. So be sure to use that link because you'll be supporting the show. And of course, you'll be getting a great discount for yourself. But enough of that. Let's get into the list at number 10. At number 10, I have Amerigo by Stefan Feld. This one is a game I really cannot get enough of. You know, the more I play this one, I just want to play it more and more and more. It's so addictive and just so much fun, as it showers you in points for doing lots of different things, as you'd probably expect with a Stefan Feld game. But the thing that really makes this game unique is this cube tower system, as each round in the game, you're going to take a bunch of cubes of a certain color, and each color cube relates to a or corresponds to a specific action you can take. You're going to drop them in this cube tower. Some of them, oh, in fact, most of them are going to filter through that cube tower and come out the bottom. But sometimes those cubes will get trapped. And that means in future rounds, when you place cubes, not only are the ones you've just placed coming through, but also ones that have been stuck in the previous rounds could get knocked off and come through as well. And the choice amongst the players is that they have to choose which action they want to take by picking a certain coloured cube that's come out of that cube tower, but the strength you get that action relates to how many cubes were knocked through in the first place. That is such a compelling decision that keeps you on track, whereas you're not completely bombarded with decisions, but the decisions you have to make are very meaningful. And these actions are going to be things such as sailing around. They could be collecting these kind of polyomino tiles. They could be building these polyomino tiles on these different landscapes in order to get points and to get these other bonuses and tokens you can collect. You are going to be fighting off pirates, because if you don't fight them off, then you are going to suffer negative points, which is a kind of running theme in a lot of Stefan Feld games. But this one, the way everything comes together, you know, you're climbing tracks, you can get unique benefits and powers you can use, and it is just an absolute blast to play. It really does. This really is a game that you can lose yourself in. You know, time just flies by because you were just having fun from the start of this game until the very end of it. I love the puzzly element of it. You know, as I said, you're mapping out these tiles and trying to build these buildings. Again, I love the tension of wanting to race to the different islands, because you get an advantage if you go there first. And it's just a game where you want to do everything, but of course you can't do everything. That decision of, you know, am I going to use this action now, or am I going to wait until those cubes get added later? You know, is this a time to capitalize on this cube coming out at this strength? It is just an amazing and fun decision, and just such a blast to play. Certainly one of the Feld games that comes through in terms of its pure fun factor. I can't get enough of it. This was last year's number 12, so it has actually climbed two places. That is Amerigo at number 10, an absolute massive recommendation if you love your Stefan Feld games. And even if you don't, I think this one could be one to change your mind. So I highly recommend checking out Amerigo. At number 9, I have Concordia, which was last year's number 6, so a 3-place drop for Concordia. But to be honest, in previous years, it's actually placed as number 9, but it's never been out of my top 10, always flitting between number 6 and 9 for some reason. But this game is an absolute masterpiece, a game where you're managing your hand of cards, which all relate to a different action. And you're going to be using these cards and playing them face up in order to sail around the map. You're going to be establishing these trading posts. You're going to be collecting money and buying and selling goods. And the idea is you want to be the first to get to these certain trade posts, because if you do, you get it at a much discounted price than if you are later to the party. But I love the scoring system in this game, as all the cards you collect not only are important because of the actions you can take by using them, but also because each of those cards is related to a specific scoring criteria. So some might say, and they're related to the god Saturn, and it'll be for every kind of region you're in on the board, you get a point for. And then, of course, the more of these cards you collect, you get 2 points for, and 3 points for, and 4 points for, and so on. So you get bigger and bigger multipliers the more you collect certain cards. Some of them might say how many works you've got on the board, or how much money you have, or how many different types of trading posts you have. So there's so many different things you can try, and having a balance between all of them is interesting. I love the tension of all the different things you have to do, because as I said, you want to be the first to get into certain regions because you get cheaper prices. But there's a communal card row out there, which you want to be the first to grab those as well. So there really is an urgency to do everything you need to, and I love the degree of planning you can do in this game, as you can really carefully map out the cards you're going to play, manage your finances very carefully to plan accordingly. But this system is so interesting because when you play a card, it's essentially discarded from your hand, but you can play an individual card to pick them all back up to be ready to use them again. But you are incentivized to play through as many cards as you can, because the more cards you play through, when you play that card to pick all your cards back up, then you get more money for doing so. Just an absolute joy to play. This is one of the smoothest, most elegant games I've ever played. And previously on the list, I mentioned how objectively Puerto Rico, I think, is one of the best games ever made. Concordia, for me, I cannot find any fault in this game. It's just an absolute genius design. I can't get enough of it. It's just so clever, so beautifully made and put together. And if you're a Eurogamer, this is one you have to try, and believe the hype on this one. It is absolutely phenomenal. So that is Concordia at number 9. At number 8, I have last year's number 4. This is Grand Austria Hotel. So this is actually previously placed as low as number 8. So a bit like Concordia, this is going up and down, up and down. But it really is a kind of a hair's width in between what these games mean to me, because they're all just out of this world. You know, they're all the best games ever made. So, but Grand Austria Hotel is such a cool design, because normally I'm not a kind of gamer who gets wrapped up in theme of games. And as you can probably tell from my list, they're all pretty dry Euros. It doesn't really mean a lot to me. But Grand Austria Hotel is a somewhat of a divergence from that, because I really do think the theme works well with this one, as you are trying to draft these dice, and all these dice are rolled, and they are, depending on the pip value, they're all going to correlate to a certain action. So, you know, all the ones will relate to collecting food, all the twos will relate to collecting drinks. But the cool thing is that when you roll these dice, they're all allocated to these spots. And you want to be considering a certain amount of things when you draft these dice, because of course the actions are important, but the number of dice in those actions is also important, because you get to take it at a stronger value. So, you know, do you want to take the actions when they're strongest, or do you want to take them when they're more rare and harder to come by? So that's a really cool, thought-provoking decision to be made there. And the idea of this game is you're trying to welcome these patrons into your hotel, you're trying to feed them and water them, and then send them off to their rooms happy, where they'll give you a bonus. You also have these really cool staff cards which you can collect and use, which will give you really game-breaking abilities that are all really dynamic and interesting to use. You'll be climbing tracks and getting points, but if you don't climb these tracks, sometimes you can suffer quite a strong penalty for not doing so. So you've got that nagging tension, all tying back to that core dice drafting mechanism, which I think it just works so, so well. And it's such an easy game to explain because it is so well tied to the theme. You know, preparing rooms, sending them off to their rooms, you know, getting them food and water. Absolutely just such a blast. This only takes about 90 minutes to play and works exceptionally well at two players. So if you're looking for a game that caters for two players, this one is out of this world for that player count. But yeah, this one is just amazing. That is Grand Austria Hotel at number 8. At number 7, I have Lorenzo Il Magnifico. So this was actually last year's number 3, and this is the first time ever that this game has fallen out of my top 3. So still never been outside my top 10, but it is a very small fall for Lorenzo. But Lorenzo is a worker placement game which has quite a cool tie to this dice system. So you're rolling a bunch of dice, and these dice are going to correspond to a worker that each player has. So you've got like the red one, the white one, and the black one. And depending on the pip value of that dice roll, relates to the strength of that specific worker. So if you rolled a 5 on the black die, then your black worker is going to be worth 5. And the idea of that is you're going to be placing them on these different towers, these towers of cards, which you're going to be trying to collect these cards by spending resources. And these cards do loads of different cool things, such as adding them to your individual player board, which will kind of create a row, almost like an engine building row, where if you go to an individual spot or a separate spot, then you can trigger all these cards that you've collected previously and get a whole bunch of resources for doing so. So it's a very satisfying game that just completely showers you in resources at certain points. And knowing when to do that is really important. But balancing that with collecting points is also a fundamental decision, because you've got cards that will give you pure set collection bonuses, or ones that will give you engine building bonuses, such as, you know, when you collect this color of card, you get a discount, or when you do this, you get it for cheaper, or you can do it much stronger. So there, it really is so much engine building going on here, not only for improvements and discounts, but also for the, again, for that row of cards that you're building throughout. Such a cool game. Some people do kind of criticize us for being influenced somewhat by the luck of that dice roll, but I've never really found that a problem, because everybody is singing from the same hymn sheet here. You know, when you roll a low bunch of dice rolls, that's going to affect all the players equally. So you're not, as an individual, being shafted by that dice roll, and it really just does, again, it completely levels the playing field. So you do have to be careful to mitigate those dice rolls by collecting these workers or these servants, which can boost the pip values of the dice that you're, or the workers that you're putting on the board. Just an absolute joy to play. So much fun, so many different things to try. And I just love the satisfaction of when you get that engine built. And this game does a great job of dangling that carrot in front of you, because as soon as you get that, your engine going to exactly where you're happy with it, the game ends, which always leaves you wanting to come back for more. So adore this game. That is Lorenzo Il Magnifico at number 7. At number 6, I actually have a new entry with Praga Caput Regni. So Praga Caput Regni is a really kitchen sink of Euro Mechanism games. Now, I can't really think of too much individual or unique things that this game does, but what it does, or everything it does, is just done to a spectacular standard. So this game, you are trying to do lots of different things. You are trying to build these buildings on this almost area control style part of the board. You're trying to travel down this road and get bonuses along the way, but you have to spend resources to do it. You are trying to use this your kind of action board and upgrade them to get more powerful actions as you go. You can build a wall around the action board to get more kind of set collection bonus points. But this all ties back to this core mechanism of this action crane, where all these different actions are put on these tiles on this rotating wheel, and every round they're going to rotate round and round and round, meaning that the longer you leave things, the cheaper they get, or even give you a bonus when you draft the tiles that have been neglected. And as I mentioned before on this list, that incentive building mechanism is one of my favourite things in board games. I love that, you know, the longer you leave things, the bigger the incentive to take it grows. And this one just does so many things. All the different parts of the game mesh together wonderfully. So many upgrades you can get. The individual player boards are fascinating, because you have to upgrade them in order to increase your capacity to collect certain resources. Or you can just choose to collect the resources in the first place, which you rotate these wheels, and when you reach a certain point, it will trigger other things. So this game is probably one of the strongest examples of a game that uses that combination, or that cascading domino effect of bonuses, that I've ever seen. You know, when you do things, it'll trigger this, it'll trigger this, it'll trigger this, and by the end of it, you're having these amazing turns that just leave you feeling just so happy with what you've achieved. What a game this one is. I cannot recommend this one enough. It's just an absolute brilliant design, and the fact this one came out in, I think it was 2020, so only last year, and Vladimir Suki is putting out games of this quality is just so exciting for me, because I just cannot wait to see what this guy puts out next, because this game is just amongst the best. That is Praga Caput Regni at number 6, a very, very high and impressive debut. At number 5, I have Maracaibo by Alexander Pfister. So I was talking about kitchen sink games. This one really is that. You know, this was last year's number 7, so it has actually climbed 2 places. This game really does it all. It has a really cool hand management system, as you're using these cards for lots of different things. Now, do you want to use the power of the card? Do you want to use it to fulfill contracts and quests? And it all ties back to this almost rondelle system, as you have this point-to-point track on the board, which is basically going around the Caribbean islands. And when you stop at certain points, you can take actions, or as I said, you can complete quests. When you, as you go out through the games and you play these cards, you can choose to almost recruit these helpers, where if you visit certain points, then you get a kind of unique action that nobody else can have. You're trying to fight your way through the rainforest and get points and bonuses along the way. You're trying to help all these different nations, because when you take this kind of conflict action, or this combat action, then you are going to get points or put these influence down, and that ties to your influence with those certain nations. So you have this multiplier where the higher you got these tracks and the higher you gain favor with these different nations, the bigger multipliers you have depending on their coverage of the board. And you've got this income tracks as well, where you want to be climbing because it'll give you more money and more points from round to round. And there's just so much to try in this game. You know, do you want to keep taking small actions, get loads along the way, or do you want to try and jump in front of the pack to get to those certain spots that to grab them before the other players do? So it does have that, again, that urgency to get to certain spots, but still wanting to drag your feet somewhat so that you get more out of your turns. What a game this one is. It's close to perfection. It's quite rules heavy, I suppose, at times if you're explaining this to someone for the first time. But once you get a head around it and you understand how everything comes together, it is just so much fun to play. Has all the Alexander Pfister goodness you'd expect, you know, upgrading your player board, etc. Just amazing, one of the best Euro games out there. That is Maracaibo at number 5. At number 4, I have Trismegistus. So this was actually last year's number 5, and in the year before that, it was number 6. So one place climbing every year for this one, which is quite an interesting statistic. This one is certainly probably the most heavy and most complex and involved Daniele Ticini games out there. Still uses that dice drafting mechanism, but in this one, you are evaluating these dice drafts with quite a few things spinning in your head. So not only do you want these symbols on these die, you also want, you're considering the colour, because different actions require certain colours to take them, and also the amount of dice in that particular pool as well. So a bit like Grand Austria Hotel, if you take a dice from a particular cluster of dice, the more there is, the more turns you're going to get in this particular game. And you're going to be basically trying to collect these different minerals, I suppose, and you'll be converting them and, what do you call it, like, well, converting them almost like an alchemy style, up these different tracks. And the more you do it, you have to spend these essences, which that you collect, climb different tracks. And you can also collect these really cool tiles, where when you go from one point to another, if you slide on the track that goes, or the route that goes past that tile, then you'll trigger its benefit. And that can really create some massive, massive turns. And the idea is you're basically trying to manage your player board to fulfill these contracts, but doing so requires very careful planning. And it certainly does burn your brain the more you get into this one. I also like the sense of progression in this game, because it really doesn't feel like you can achieve much, because I think it's only 3 rounds, and I think in each of those 3 rounds you only get 3 turns, so there isn't much use of actually actions. You have to pick each action very carefully because there isn't that much margin for error. But that kind of ties into this interaction in the game, because you have these tokens which allow you to piggyback off the other player's actions, and that corresponds to the dice or the die that they've drafted. So you really do have to be careful when to use them, when to capitalize on that, and when to kind of strike when the iron is hot. So you have to be engaged not only on your turn, but on other players' turns as well, which I think is a great addition to the game. So much going on here, you know, way too much to explain in a, you know, in a minute clip like this. But if you like Daniele Ticini games, if you like you having your brain burnt and having to think in different ways and spin a lot of plates, get upgrades galore, massive combos, then Trismegistus is the best of the best. Highly recommend it. Trismegistus at number 4. At number 3, I actually have a new entry, so hugely impressive. This game absolutely blew me away, and I do not say that lightly. This is Barrage. So Barrage, as I said, not often now after playing so many games am I left just completely just astounded by the design of a game, and this one is an example of that. I was so impressed with this game, I couldn't get enough of it. I still can. It is just absolutely mind-blowing how well this game is put together. So this is a game about water and harvesting water to generate energy, basically. But it all ties back to this board, which basically is a mountainscape, meaning that along this mountain, at the highest point, you're going to have these different pools of water, or these dams. And then you can have one at the midway point and ones at the bottom as well. And the idea is that every round there's going to be a number of water drops added to these different points on the mountain, and they're going to filter down at certain points. And the idea is you want to be building these dams in order to collect that water, and then you'll be converting that water into energy. But this game has so much player interaction, and because, you know, initially you might be building the dams at the bottom of the mountain because it's cheapest and it's the only place you can afford and you want to be harnessing something. But later in the game, another player might jump higher up the mountain, meaning that they collect that water before it gets to you. But sometimes they won't build their dams high enough, meaning that some water will still filter through and get collected in your dam. And you can even like shift water from the one place to another. And I love the worker placement element of this game as well. While this game, I wouldn't say the takeaway thing is the worker placement, I do like the idea of when you trigger certain things and when you start building things, you actually have to dedicate the resources to this action wheel. And not only does it mean that your resources are tied up and you've basically spent them, they're not actually gone for good, because once this a certain action space you can take is to rotate that wheel around, and when it gets all the way back around, you get all those resources back. So it adds this whole new dimension of time into the game, where you are tying up your resources to build stuff and not just getting rid of them. And that just adds a whole new layer of complexity and planning into it. Again, just the interaction in this game is amazing. It can feel a bit nasty at times, but you are doing it for a reason. And it's just so great. You're building up these energy, trying to get to certain points to get bonuses as well, trying to fulfill these contracts. And it just has everything going on in this game. And just despite its complexity and richness and depth, this game is actually surprisingly easy to teach, and the addition that each player also has their unique ability and their own player board with their own specialities just adds so much flavour and so much spice to the game as well. Absolutely love it. Blown away. Incredible. Barrage. At number two, I have Trajan by Stefan Feld. This was actually last year's number two, so it's held its place. But it's actually placed as low as number 11. So this has actually been a grower over time. It's got better and better for me. And obviously the rankings reflects that. Apologies if you're fatigued with Stefan Feld games. But he's one of my favourite designers. And obviously the list reflects that. But this one is my favourite of the Stefan Felds. And so spoiler alert, my number one isn't a Stefan Feld game. But this one is basically a bunch of mini games set in Rome. And the idea is that you're trying to get as many points as you can. So it really is the traditional Feld point salad game. But it all is using this Mancala system, where your individual player board has a bunch of these bowls on them, all corresponding to a different action. And you're going to have these tokens in these bowls. And the idea is you're going to pick up the tokens in one of these bowls and you're going to move them, pick them all up and drop one off along the way. And the bowl you end in is the action you take for that round. And these actions will be going like on military conquests, to try and conquer the forum to get these different tiles for big end game scoring. You're trying to climb the Senate track to get these another more end game scoring criteria. You can try and collect and sell these cards for points. So it really is a bunch of individual mini games, really. But the way they tie together is quite cool and interesting. And I love this part of the game where you can go to a certain spot and buy these bonus tiles, which means that when you line up certain colours on your Mancala, you'll get a follow-up bonus as well, which can give you a bunch of points or give you another action. So you can take really strong turns. Just like Amerigo, this game does have that nagging tension of having to fulfil the needs of the people in this one, where you need to be collecting certain tiles, and if you don't, you suffer negative points at the end of the round. The pacing in this game is also interesting, because it's not a fixed amount of rounds. It's a it's based on the amount of Mancala spaces players go around on the board. So sometimes rounds can be a lot quicker than others if people are taking these big, strong moves. I think this game is just mind-blowing how well put together it is. It does work together like clockwork, perfectly balanced, different routes to victory. You can really see the cogs working in this game, but I just, it blows my mind the degree of planning and just design prowess that Stefan Feld can do in his games with a game like Trajan. Just an unbelievable game, and it's just mind-blowing how good it is. That is Trajan at number two. And finally, at number one, my favourite game of all time, El Grande. So if you're probably a regular fan of my channel or a regular viewer of my content, you're probably aware that I'm a massive fan of El Grande. This was last year's number one. I think it was the year before that's number one. It has previously placed as low as number two, but that's hardly a criticism. El Grande is the forefather of the area majority games. I didn't think there was much before this one that used that system. This one dates back to 1996, I believe, and the fact that this is still the strongest game of that massively convoluted and massively bloated genre of games just says so much about this one. So pure in the way this one works. As you're basically just trying to have your caballeros, which is like your player pieces, in these different regions and have the majority to get the most points. But the kind of dynamism of this game and the way that everything comes together is so, so clever. And the way you're taking these actions in the first place, using this drafting system as you have a bunch of power tokens or power cards in your hand, and you're playing these power cards in order to get priority of the actions available for the round. So the higher value you play is great because you get, again, you get priority of taking the cards you want, which can be to shift things around in your favor or to move this king piece around in order to lock your pieces in and to get additional points. But I love the fact that when you play these higher cards, you actually take fewer caballeros into your supply. So you need to balance taking high cards in order to get the priority of the cards, but you need to play the low cards so that you have a constant flow of people to put onto the board. And after that, you've even got massive decisions in actually taking the actions in the first place. You know, when do you want to play these high cards to get the king? You know, is this the right time to do this action? You've got this really interesting part of the game called the Castillo, where instead of openly placing your workers onto the board, then you can put them inside the castle, which uses a bit of memory into it, but the person who commits the most caballeros into the castle at the end of the round gets another bunch of points, and then you can actually redistribute them using this blind bidding system, which just wraps up the complexity and can add that fuzziness into who's going to control those regions at the end. Do I play it safe and bolster my things over here, or do I go for the kill and try and snatch the majority there? So it's just so much fun, so much going on here. Things are always shifting and changing, and it really is just a matter of just manipulating the board at all times so you capitalize off that. What a game this one is. It's a masterpiece. It stood the test of time just remarkably. If this game was released in 2021, I would still, you know, be amazed by this one because the design is that good. It's timeless. It's elegant. It's just an absolute masterpiece. Again, I can't say enough good things about this one. It's my number one game of all time. So do yourself a favor and try this one if you haven't tried it. I know gamers who don't normally like this style of aesthetic or style of game, you know, the dry Euro games, and have still come away from El Grande just absolutely enamored with the design and loving it and having a blast. So a great experience in 90 minutes. Yeah, you do need 4 or 5 players to get the full benefit from the game. It does work okay with 3. If you've got those regular higher player counts, you know, 4 or 5 players, then it does not get any better, you know, literally, than El Grande. So, number one game, I think 3 years running. What more praise can I give it? El Grande, number one. So, that concludes this series of my top 50 board games of all time. I really sincerely hope that you've enjoyed the list. I love talking about them because, of course, why wouldn't you love about talking things you're so passionate about? I want to say that, you know, this is kind of a snapshot in time, really. You know, there's so many good games here, and every day my list is changing, things are moving up and things are moving down. But the takeaway thing is that all these games are just utterly fantastic. I know a lot of people did want my top 100 board games of all time, and to cater for those, I will be doing a live stream covering from number 50 to 100, and we'll also cover some kind of analysis as well, talking about why things have moved up, why things have gone down, games that have fallen off the list from last year, etc. So be sure to subscribe to the channel, and also hit a like just to show your support if you've enjoyed it as well. Additionally, as I mentioned at the beginning of the video, if you do live in the UK and you regularly buy games, I would highly recommend checking out keyender.co.uk and using my discount code, because they are really a great bunch of guys and a great company just starting and getting going. And I generally do shop there when I can because they offer a great service, great prices and really great loyalty schemes. So for everyone else, thank you so, so much. Check out my Patreon account if you haven't done so already. If you do want to go that extra step to support the channel, it certainly will be appreciated. But for everyone else, I'll see you next time on Chairman of the Board. Bye.